like you're slipping right on through my finger. And I've spent all my energy on you. I have nothing left to offer. I give and I give, but you still want more. So tell me what it's gonna take.
Okay, where am I? Hello. I just realized I am trying out the OBS software tonight, but I just realized I set up a gaming page, but did not set up my chat page for when I'm reading. I think I can actually do that on the fly, though. So, give me a second here, and we'll just try it out. I'm going to switch over to it, and let's go, let's see, video capture device. There we go. And where is it? Oh, I have to actually choose the one. Duh. It should just be that, but it's not showing it. Okay, well. Configure video. That's not it. Oh. All right. Try that again. How about that? Does that work? No, it doesn't. It's just giving you guys a black screen. Okay. Well. I don't know what to do with that. So, we can just use this for the moment. Like that. And we'll just go from there. I'll figure it out. First time using this. Game now, read later. It's easy enough to adjust that. I don't know why it's not letting me make a new screen. But that'll work. Still got the captions working and everything. How's the sound? A little more volume. Okay. That's actually maxed out. On my mic volume. So, all right, well, we'll just go with it. All right. So we're on chapter one, Bruce and his struggle for power. So we're going to be, looks like we're getting into Robert the Bruce. So, all right. On 18 May 1291, Acre, the last bastion of the Western Crusaders in the Holy Land, fell to the Saracens, and the Latin kingdom of Jerusalem, born of the First Crusade nearly two centuries before, finally and irrevocably collapsed, thus ending the great European dream of a Christian Middle East. The resonant and sacred sites of Scripture from Egypt through Palestine to Lebanon and Syria were to remain in Islamic hands, effectively off-limits to Christians until Napoleon's time, some five centuries later. With the loss of the Holy Land, the Knights Templar lost not only their primary sphere of military operations, but also their primary raison d'être. In military terms, at least, they could no longer justify their existence. Their kindred military religious orders had bases elsewhere and other crusades to fight. The Knights Hospitaller of St. John were to establish themselves first on Rhodes, then on Malta, and to spend the next three centuries wresting control of the Mediterranean for an ever more mercantile Christendom. The Teutonic Knights had already found their new vocation on the Baltic, exterminating the pagan tribes there and creating a Christian principality which extended from Prussia through Latvia, Lithuania, and Estonia to the Gulf of Finland. The Spanish orders of Santiago, Calatrava, and Alcantara had yet to expel the Moors from the Iberian Peninsula, while the Portuguese Knights of Christ were to devote themselves increasingly to maritime exploration. Only the Templars, most wealthy, most powerful, and most prestigious of the orders, were left without a purpose and without a home. Their own ambition to establish a principality for themselves in the Languedoc was thwarted and remained stillborn. The decade and a half that followed the fall of Acre was to be a period of decline for the temple. Then at dawn on Friday the 13th, October 1307, Philippe IV of France ordered the arrest of all Templars in his domains. During the next 7 years, the Inquisition moved on to the center of the stage to finish what the French king had started. Templars throughout Europe were imprisoned, tried, interrogated, tortured, and executed. In 1312, the Order of the Temple was officially dissolved by the Pope. In 1314, the last Grand Master of the Order, Jacques de Molay, was burned at the stake, and the Temple effectively ceased to exist. Robert Bruce's career spans this crucial period precisely. He first appeared in a position of prominence in 1292, a year after the fall of Acre, when he became Earl of Carrick. His life attained its climax with the Battle of Bannockburn in 1314, some 3 months after Jacques de Molay's death. In 1306, a year before the persecution of the temple began, Bruce himself had been excommunicated and was to remain at odds with the papacy for another 12 years. Because he had ceased to be recognized by the Pope, it was impossible for Rome to treat with him or impose her will in his domains. In effect, the papal writ no longer ran in Scotland, or at least those parts of Scotland which Bruce controlled, and which lay therefore beyond the pale, and thus in those parts of Scotland the decree which abolished the temple elsewhere in Europe was not, in accordance with the strict letter of the law, applicable. If knights of the order fleeing persecution on the continent hoped to find a refuge anywhere, it would have been under Bruce's protection. A spate of archaic legends and traditions has for centuries linked Bruce and the Templars, even if the association between them has not been satisfactorily defined. The graves in Argyll provided persuasive evidence for those legends of... legends and traditions. They dated from the relevant period and were located in a region where it would have been natural for refugee Templars to seek safety. The closer one looks at Bruce, moreover, the clearer it becomes that he and the Templars had much in common. The Celtic Kingdom of Scotland. Bruce is usually perceived as the central figure in medieval Scotland's struggle for independence, but Bruce was intent on something more, something much more radical and much more ambitious than just thwarting English domination. What he sought was nothing less than the restoration of a uniquely Celtic kingdom with specifically Celtic institutions. These may even have included ritual human sacrifice. In medieval Ireland and Wales, even where England's Norman sovereigns had not established their sway, there was no centralized authority. But countries were torn by internecine. I've never seen that word. Internecine squabbles between a multitude of local princelings or chieftains and their clans. Scotland was the only Celtic realm with well-formed and independent political institutions at the beginning of the High Middle Ages. In Rome, In Roman times, of course, Scotland had been dominated by the Picts, who continued to play a prominent role in Scottish history until the mid-9th century. But in the late 5th century, Celtic settlers from Ireland, particularly from Ulster, had begun to settle in the west of the country and to establish what is now called the Kingdom of the Dalriada. One of whose ancient strongholds was Dunad, just 3 miles from Kilmartin. For 350 years, the Dalriada in the west and the Picts elsewhere struggled for supremacy, each at intervals gaining temporary ascendancy, then losing it again. Though often violent, the struggle was not always so. It was also cultural and dynastic, and there were periodic high-level intermarriages between the two peoples. By 843, I would say that's CE, however, the Dalriada had effectively triumphed. The Picts were not so much defeated militarily as subsumed. Pictish language and culture entirely, albeit gradually, disappeared, and Scotland, under the aegis of the Dalriada king Kenneth MacAlpine, became a unified Celtic kingdom. Around 850, Kenneth was installed at Scone as monarch of all Scotland. There were still to be internal vicissitudes, intrigues, and strife of the kind immortalized by Shakespeare in Macbeth, but under Kenneth MacAlpine's descendant, David I, The feudal kingdom of Scotland finally emerged in 1124, a quarter of a century after Western crusaders had established the Latin kingdom of Jerusalem. Although the Normans had first ventured into Scotland under William Rufus, son of William the Conqueror, there was no large-scale or successful Norman penetration until David's time. David himself was thoroughly Celtic, the son of the Celtic king, Malcolm III. During his reign, however, large numbers of Norman and also Flemish knights were allowed into the country. So too was monasticism, chiefly under the auspices of the Cistercians. Nevertheless, Scotland remained a wholly Celtic kingdom, and there is evidence that such Celtic thought, both pagan and Christian, persisted there long after it had vanished from Ireland. Among the unique institutions created by David was the office subsequently hereditary of the royal steward of the realm, later called the Stuart, the office from which the Stuart dynasty was to derive. So, just as a note, because you can't see the text, the first steward, the royal steward, S-T-E-W-A-R-D, of the realm, later became the Stuart, S-T-E-W-A-R-T, the office from which the Stuart, S-T-U-A-R-T, dynasty was to derive, because it is relevant. The steward was a kind of hereditary manager of the royal household, or hereditary court chancellor, very similar to the so-called mayor of the palace, or more in Merovingian France 3 centuries before. Just as the mayors of the palace eventually supplanted the Merovingians and formed the Carolingian dynasty, so in Scotland the stewards, though more peacefully, were to supplant the dynasty of David. The first steward, Walter FitzAlan, was of Celtic Breton descent, the son of one Alan FitzFlald. Alan may also have been descended from the Scottish Thane Banquo of Lochaber, L-O-C-H-A-B-E-R, sorry about the pronunciations, whose legend finds its way into Shakespeare's play. Lochaber, maybe? I don't know. Among King David's entourage was a Norman knight, Robert de Bruce. David conferred upon him the Vale of Annan, which guarded the approaches to Scotland through Carlisle. He was also a close friend of the English King Henry I and held extensive lands in Yorkshire. Robert's family is generally believed to have come from Bruce or Bruis, or now Brix, just south of Cherbourg. More recently, however, it has been suggested that he was in fact of Flemish origin, descended from Robert de Bruges, the wealthy Castellan of the city 3/4 of a century before. Robert disappeared from Bruges in 1053, the year in which Matilda of Flanders married William, Duke of Normandy. He may well have accompanied her into France, and then 13 years later accompanied her husband on the invasion of England. Although the Robert de Bruce of King David's time was of Norman and possibly Flemish descent, his great-grandson married David's great-granddaughter, the niece of the Celtic kings Malcolm IV and William I. The Robert Bruce, who was later to figure so prominently in Scottish history, could thus claim blood descent from the ancient Celtic royal house and eventually back to Kenneth MacAlpine of the Dalriada. And when Robert Bruce's daughter married Walter the Steward, or Stuart, with a W, the dynasty later known as the Stuarts, U-A-R-T-S, was born. The Celtic element remained prevalent in Scottish society until the end of the 13th century. Thus, for example, the most influential noblemen in the realm were the 13 earls, or thanes, who derived their lineage and authority directly from the older kingdom of the Dalreda. I have never heard them referred to as thanes. I always wondered where that term came from in Skyrim, actually, and now I know. Among these earls, the most important was the Earl of Fife, who exercised their hereditary right to place the new king on the throne during the coronation ceremony. The coronation itself was traditionally held at Scone, 2 miles up the Tay River from Perth, and the throne of the kingdom was built around the famous Stone of Scone, supposedly brought to the site by Kenneth MacAlpine in 850. Scone itself was a sacred or semi-sacred place since pre-Celtic Pictish times. Its central point was the Hill of Belief, now called Moot Hill. Here, in a ritual dating back beyond recorded history, a new monarch would be seated on a stone and invested with the regalia of his office, including probably a rod and a mantle. Thus would the king be wedded to the land, to the people he ruled, and to the earth goddess herself, often portrayed in animal guise. In the Irish version of the rite, a mare would be sacrificed and boiled in water, which the newly installed king bathed, while drinking the broth and eating the beast's flesh. In this way, it was believed the fertility of the land and the people would be ensured. By the 12th century, in the wake of the Crusades, this archaic principle, the monarch's responsibility for the land's fertility, would be amalgamated with schemes of esoteric Judeo-Christian tradition to produce the corpus of poems now known as the Grail Romances. These, as we shall see, were to have a very specific pertinence in Scotland. To Scotland. The coronation of Alexander III in 1249 was typical of the Celtic rites that prevailed in Scotland long after they had vanished elsewhere. When Alexander was seated on the throne at Scone, an aged Highland bard formally recited in Gaelic the new monarch's genealogy back through the Dalreda to the first Scotsman. As might be expected of a Celtic ruler, Alexander was always accompanied by a harpist. When he traveled, he would be preceded, as tradition decreed for a Celtic chieftain, by 7 women singing his glory and his pedigree, a flattering practice at first, no doubt, which must quickly have become both noisy and boring. Not surprisingly, in such a milieu, the church exercised only the most tenuous of holds. During the 9th century, Scotland seems briefly to have provided a refuge for surviving splinter groups of the Celtic Church in Ireland. Under one of these splinter groups, the Celidae, or Culdees, I know it's Irish, I don't know how to pronounce Irish, and it never sounds like it looks. So a monastic system was established, but never came to wield the influence it did across the Irish Sea. Despite an influx of Cistercians in the 12th century, the Roman Church had all but disappeared. In Lothian, for example, no bishopric was to be founded after 950, circa 950, nor was any religious community to be founded in Strathclyde after that date. But the Celtic kingdom of Scotland, which had attained its apotheosis with Alexander III, was to die with him. In March 1286, returning one stormy night from a council at Edinburgh, the king became separated from his escort and was found the next morning with a broken neck. His demise was not only to precipitate a major internal crisis and a bitter struggle for the throne, it was also to provide England with an excuse for meddling on a hitherto unprecedented scale in Scottish affairs. And it does have a 2-page map here.
not sure how much you're going to be able to see. It's got the islands. I don't know. I'll go ahead and show it to you. So, let's see. Whoop. There we go. Kind of hard to see with it. I don't think you can read any of that. I'll come in. There we go. Now, I'll just pan across and down. So, it's showing a lot of the places I'm sure they'll be talking about in, and they have been talking about in here. All right. So, the emergence of Bruce. So, before I jump into that, there is another illustration of his family tree. I'll go ahead and show you that, and then I'll go ahead and read that page so we can move on. So, genealogy showing relationship of Robert Bruce to earlier kings of Scotland. Come on. There we go. All the way down there, and then that square, that gray square is Robert Bruce. There we go. Okay, so. Alexander died without sons. His only daughter, Margaret, was married to the King of Norway, and Scotland had no desire for a Norwegian ruler. Accordingly, a provisional government was formed, consisting of six guardians of the peace, the Earl of Fife as premier peer, the Earl of Buchan, James the Stuart, John Comyn, and the bishops of Glasgow and St. Andrews. Acting as a regency, this council decided to confer the crown on Margaret of Norway's daughter, who also named Margaret, who was then an infant. It was arranged that the child, on attaining her maturity, would marry Prince Edward, subsequently Edward II of England. But in 1290, en route home from Norway, the young Margaret died, and the question of the Scottish succession was plunged into turmoil. More than a dozen candidates presented themselves as claimants to the throne, including John Baliol and the grandfather of Robert Bruce, known as the Competitor. So great was the danger of civil war that the Bishop of St. Andrews invited Edward I of England to arbitrate. Thus, the Norman monarchy of England received a mandate to intervene in the affairs of the Celtic Kingdom of Scotland. Edward wasted no time in turning his mandate to his own advantage. When he met with the Scottish claimants in 1291, he proceeded to claim suzerainty? I don't know what that is. Suzerainty. Suzerainty? I don't know. Over Scotland for himself. So, despite protests, the Scottish lords were bullied and intimidated into at least a partial acknowledgement of the English king's self-arrogated status. Having exhorted his acknowledgement, he judged the succession to devolve upon John Baliol, who had a legitimate claim, and was duly crowned by Scone, at Scone. Edward immediately reneged on his promises to respect Scottish independence, demanding a humiliating obedience and fealty from the man he had placed on the throne. In 1294, the English king's demands had goaded the Scots into rebellion. An alliance was formed with France, and Baliol in 1296 repudiated his allegiance to Edward. By then, however, it was too late. Edward had already sacked Berwick and advanced with his army into Scotland. The Scots were defeated, Baliol having surrendered, was publicly humiliated and eventually went into exile. With Scotland at his feet, Edward embarked on a systematic campaign to eradicate all vestiges, both political and religious, of the old Celtic kingdom. The Stone of Scone, most archaic and sacred of Celtic talismans, was accorded special attention. At Edward's behest, the inscription on it was erased and the stone itself removed from Scone and brought to London. The Great Seal of Scotland was smashed, and coffers of royal records were confiscated. Edward appointed himself, in effect, an ad hoc defender of the faith, the archetypal Christian king promulgating the rule of Rome. To bolster this image, it was profitable to emphasize the pagan aspects of the old Celtic kingdom, which were portrayed as heretical, if not pagan, and satanic. By disseminating rumors of sorcery and necromancy, Edward was able to show moral and theological justification for his crusade to annex Scotland. Having quelled all resistance in the country, Edward left its government in the hands of his own appointee, the Earl of Warrenne. Warrenne remained arrogantly disdainful of his role, and a year later, in 1297, William Wallace gave the signal for a general rising by assassinating the Sheriff of Lanark. He then proceeded with William Douglas to attack the pro-English judiciary at Scone. Wallace's insurrection was coordinated with similar activity elsewhere under the leadership of the Bishop of Glasgow and James the Stuart. It was against this turbulent background that the figure of Robert Bruce suddenly emerged. Fomenting rebellion in the south, Bruce had already been made Earl of Carrick, one of the largest, most powerful, and most deeply Celtic fiefdoms in the country, encompassing most of the western region known as Galloway. His followers and vassals controlled vast tracts of land in Ulster, including all of North Antrim, parts of what is now County Londonderry, and Rathlin Island off the coast. Bruce's own holdings, apart from Carrick, included a third of the fiefdom of Huntingdon, Gerioch, and Dundee. As we have seen, Bruce was of royal blood, his great-grandfather having married into the line descended from David I. Toward the end of 1297, Wallace contrived to secure the election of William Lamberton, Chancellor of Glasgow Cathedral, as Bishop of St. Andrews, Scotland's premier bishopric. Lamberton being a fierce patriot, his investiture, it was hoped, would strengthen the Scottish cause. He promptly embarked from Rome to have his election confirmed by the Pope. To have his election confirmed by the Pope and to appeal to the papacy on behalf of his comrades in arms. Meanwhile, Wallace was knighted by a prominent Scottish earl, possibly Bruce himself, and in 1298 was elected sole guardian of the country. By the spring of that year, however, the revolt had provoked another full-scale English invasion. On 19 and 20 of July, 1298, the English army of 2,000 horse and 12,000 foot pitched camp near Falkirk on the Templar estates of Temple Liston, now covered by Edinburgh Airport. Edward's forces were supported by a contingent of Templars and included, significantly enough, two of the order's high dignitaries, the Master of England and the Preceptor of Scotland. At this time, the temple had not yet come under persecution and had no particular reason to feel threatened. Even so, its alignment with the English king was highly irregular, an anomaly for which historians have offered no satisfactory explanation. The Templars had always been strictly forbidden to participate in secular warfare, especially against a Christian monarch. Their sole raison d'être was to engaged in a very specific kind of conflict, the Crusade, which was scrupulously defined as hostilities conducted against the infidel. The Scots were hardly infidels, and Scotland was under papal protection. Indeed, Bishop Lamberton had just been personally confirmed in his appointment by Pope Boniface VIII, and the only explanation for the Templar involvement is that the pagan and or old Celtic practices among the rebel Scots were sufficiently prominent to warrant a species of mini crusade. In any case, at the Battle of Falkirk on 22 July 1298, the Scots were badly savaged. English losses were negligible. Only two major figures, in fact, were killed on the English side. These were the two high dignitaries of the Temple. Following his defeat at Falkirk, Wallace was forced to resign as guardian, but this did not terminate the revolt. In the autumn of 1298, the rebels appointed John Comyn and Robert Bruce to preside as joint guardians and continue the struggle. They, however, soon fell to squabbling among themselves, and the friction between them not only deflected them from concerted action against the English, but also nearly got Bruce killed. In 1299, therefore, when Bishop Lamberton returned from Rome, he was appointed third guardian to arbitrate between his compatriots. In fact, Lamberton was strongly sympathetic towards Bruce and was soon embroiled in his own quarrel with Comyn. Disgusted by all the discord, Bruce resigned, leaving Scotland temporarily in the hands of Comyn and Lamberton, and proceeded to consolidate his position by other means. These entailed two important dynastic alliances. Early in the 1290s, Bruce had married Isabel, daughter of the Earl of Mar, while his sister Christina married Isabel's brother, who succeeded to the earldom. By his marriage to Isabel of Mar, Bruce had a daughter, Marjorie, who in 1315 was to marry Walter, son of James the Stuart. But in 1302, Isabel of Mar having died, Bruce undertook with impressive expediency the forging of a temporary alliance with the English. He married Elizabeth de Bourges, daughter of the Earl of Ulster, a loyal supporter of the English king. Since the days of the Dalriada, there had been a close connection, both cultural and political, between Ulster and Bruce's own earldom of Carrick. This is discernible even today in the frequency with which Carrick figures as a prefix for place names in Northern Ireland. By marrying the daughter of the Earl of Ulster, Bruce was able to reactivate the old allegiances between his own fiefdom in Scotland and the Irish lands owned by the former lords of Carrick. He was now in a position to muster considerable support and manpower from across the Irish Sea, and with allies in Ulster, a crucial maritime route could be kept open for supplies and material. In the meantime, the revolt continued without him. At the Battle of Roslyn in 1303, Comyn defeated a small English contingent. This, however, proved a short-lived success, for in 1304, Edward invaded Scotland again, forcing Comyn to submit and swear allegiance to the English crown. In 1305, the cause of Scottish independence deteriorated further with the capture of Wallace. With a barbarity extreme even in the Middle Ages, Wallace was quite literally overkilled. He was dragged behind a horse for 4 miles from Westminster to Smithfield, castrated, hanged, cut down while still alive, disemboweled, and decapitated. His body was dismembered into 4 pieces, which were placed on display in different locations. The murder of John Comyn is the next. Let's see, how far, just out of curiosity, how many pages do we have left? Twelve more pages. Okay, or 11. The murder of John Comyn. Wallace was dead and Comyn firmly under the English thumb. But in March 1304, a year before Wallace's capture, Bruce's father had died, leaving Bruce with a direct claim to the throne. 3 months later, in June, he had concluded a secret agreement with Bishop Lamberton. The tenets of this agreement were never stated publicly or explicitly, but in the words of one of Bruce's biographers, G.W.S. Barrow, it spoke darkly of rivals and dangers. It is now generally accepted that the agreement involved plans for the independent Celtic Scotland, over which Bruce, supported by Lamberton, would preside as monarch. Before any such project could be implemented, however, something had to be done about John Comyn. The Comyn family, which included the earldoms of Buchan, I'm assuming that's Buchan because Buchanan just adds another A-N on the end of the word, so Buchan and Monteith, was an old one and could match the Bruces in power and prestige. John Comyn himself, the head of the house's senior line, was among his other titles, Lord of Lochaber, Badenoch, and Tynedale. Although he had quarreled with Bruce and Lamberton, his integrity as a Scottish patriot had never previously been impugned. With his submission in 1304 to Edward of England, however, he became fair game and vulnerable. Subsequent events have proved perplexing. Much was unexplained, even at the time. Much appears to have been deliberately suppressed. What is certain is that on 10 February 1306, at the Church of the Grey Friars in Dumfries, Bruce, with his own hand, murdered his adversary. Comyn was stabbed with a dagger before the high altar and left to bleed to death on the church's stone floor. According to several accounts, he did not die immediately and was carried to safety by the monks who sought to minister to his wounds. Bruce, hearing of this, returned to the church, dragged him back to the altar, and there slaughtered him. When Comyn's uncle attempted to intervene, he was in turn cut down by Bruce's brother-in-law, Christopher Seton. Writing 69 years after the event, John Barber, the only major chronicler of the time and Bruce's first biographer, was curiously vague about this matter. Curiously because Barber is generally exhaustive in his detail, precisely noting names, dates, and statistics. Barber describes the murder itself at some length, but says virtually nothing about what led to it. He suggests tentatively that Bruce and Comyn had jointly formed a pact against the English on which Comyn sought to renege. He suggests that the two men happened more or less accidentally to meet in the church and that the murder occurred on the spur of the moment in a sudden fit of temper following accusations of treachery. But he himself then admits that other explanations exist, while studiously contriving not to recount them. Later historians acknowledge that there must have been more to the matter than meets the eye, but such explanations as they have ventured are scarcely adequate. There are aspects of Comyn's murder that cannot be explained entirely by the betrayal of a pact or by the long-standing antipathy between Bruce and himself. In the first place, there is persuasive evidence that Comyn's murder was not a spontaneous act of anger. On the contrary, it appears to have been carefully premeditated, perhaps even rehearsed. Comyn seems to have been lured to the church deliberately. Moreover, he was bound to have been attended by an entourage of his own soldiery, who, with the exception of his uncle, stood by and did nothing. Nor is it possible to ignore the setting of the murder. Churches, after all, were deemed to be sacred ground, providing right of sanctuary. It was strictly forbidden to shed blood in a church, and this taboo was held in awed respect by the most powerful men of the age. Even on those rare occasions when murders were committed in churches, Thomas a Beckett's, for example, they were generally committed in fashion calculated not to shed blood. For Bruce to have used so messy an expedient as a dagger, to have dragged Cohen back to the altar after he had been rescued by the monks, and to have displayed no remorse or penitence afterwards, suggests more than a loss of temper. It also suggests explicit, even flamboyant, defiance, not only of the English authority to which Cohen had sworn allegiance, but also of Rome. More even than a repudiation of Edward, Cohen's murder seems to have signaled a repudiation of the papacy. What is more, it appears the unmistakable stamp of a ritual killing, an almost ceremonial killing of one candidate for the throne by another, on consecrated ground in accordance with archaic pagan tradition. Nobody at the time could have been unaware of the powerful symbolism inherent in Bruce's act, a symbolism so powerful indeed as to transcend the act itself. How are we doing on time here? I don't know. I don't see time on here. Okay. Well, anyway. The Pope reacted. He could only have been expected to react. Bruce was summarily excommunicated and was to remain so for more than a decade. And yet, significantly enough, this made no impression whatever on the Scottish clergy. Lamberton issued not a word of criticism of his friend and ally. Neither did Bishop Wishart of Glasgow. The second most important ecclesiastic in the country at the time, in whose diocese the murder had taken place. If anything, both prelates seem to have endorsed Bruce's behavior and to have expected it beforehand. To return to G.W.S. Barrow, quote, "It does not seem rash to guess that Wishart knew in advance approximately when the coup was to be carried out," end quote. With Cohen dead, Bruce immediately laid claim to the throne. Lamberton supported him. So, too, did Wishart. Indeed, Bruce, having dispatched his rival, promptly set out for Glasgow, where Wishart received him for high-level discussions. And when Bruce embarked on a fresh campaign against the English, both Lamberton and Wishart, flagrantly indifferent to Rome, extolled it as a veritable crusade. Oh, there's my time. 47 minutes. Okay. With this ecclesiastical blessing, Bruce proceeded to seize the castles commanding the Firth of Clyde, thus protecting supply routes to Ulster and the Western Isles. As if on cue, Bishop Wishart conjured out of hiding the old royal robes and vestments, as well as a banner bearing the arms of the ancient Celtic royal house. Lamberton, meanwhile, supposedly presiding at Berwick over the English council delegated to rule Scotland, slipped away. He surfaced at Scone, where 6 weeks after Comyn's death, he formally crowned Bruce king, performed a mass for the new monarch, did homage, and pledged fealty. Historians are agreed that, whatever the circumstances involved in Comyn's murder, these events had to have been prearranged. There were, in fact, two quite separate coronations, the first of which few details survive. Seemed to have been more or less conventional and to have taken place on 25 March 1306 in the Abbey Church at Scone. Lamberton presided, attended by Wishart. Bishop Murray of Moray, the abbots of Scone and Inchifray, the earls of Lennox, Monteith, Athol, and probably of Mar. The second coronation took place 2 days later and involved Bruce being placed upon the throne of Scone in accordance with ancient Celtic custom. Traditionally, he should have been ushered on to the royal seat by the country's premier peer, the Earl of Fife, who had for centuries played this role in the crowning of Scottish kings. At the time, however, the Earl of Fife had only just come of age and was wholly in the power of Edward of England. In consequence, the boy's function was discharged by his sister, Isabel, wife of the Earl of Buchan, one of Comyn's cousins, who rode north from her estates in England especially to perform the ceremony. In the past, historians had tended to regard Bruce's career and his campaign for Scottish independence as essentially political, rather than cultural. In consequence, the Celtic element has been largely ignored, and Bruce has been portrayed as a typical Norman potentate of the era. Quote, "It is only in comparatively recent times that the contribution of Celtic Scotland to the struggle has been appreciated," end quote. Now, in fact, it becomes apparent that the contribution of Celtic Scotland was crucial. As a specifically Celtic leader intent on restoring an ancient Celtic kingdom, Bruce's campaign was not just political, but cultural and ethnic as well. Thus, for example, in 1307, when Edward lay on his deathbed, Bruce's propagandist disseminated tales of an alleged prophecy of Merlin. According to this prophecy, the Celtic peoples on Edward's death would unite, attain independence, create their own kingdom, extending presumably across the Irish Sea, and live together in peace. Such prophecies, however, were decidedly premature. Both England and Rome reacted swiftly to Bruce's coronation. For if England saw a restored Celtic monarchy as a political threat, Rome saw it as something even more ominous, a possible resurrection in Scotland of the old, potentially heretical Celtic Church, or worse still, a return to pre-Christian paganism. The general indifference in Scotland to Bruce's excommunication was alarming. So too was the insouciance with which further papal fulminations were received. More difficult to dismiss was the English reaction. By this time, Bruce's support was considerable. It included, in addition to the Scotland's most prominent earls, such important families as the Frasers, the Hayes, the Campbells, the Montgomerys, the Lindsays, and the Settons, some of whom will figure later in this story, but such support was still not sufficient to stem the advance of the English army when it again took the field. On 19 June 1306, at the Battle of Methven, Edward caught the Scots before dawn and inflicted a crushing defeat upon them. The Earl of Athol was captured and executed, as were Simon Fraser, Neil Bruce, Christopher Seton, and his brother John. Nor did the ladies associated with Bruce's cause escape the English wrath. Isabel, Countess of Buchan, who had participated in Bruce's Celtic coronation, was placed in a cage hung on a wall outside Berwick Castle and kept there for 4 years until 1310. Bruce's sister, Mary, was imprisoned in a similar cage in a tower of Roxburgh Castle and not released until 1314. Marjorie, Bruce's 12-year-old daughter, was initially sentenced to incarceration in a third cage, this one at the Tower of London, but sense or influence prevailed and she was consigned to a convent instead. For a number of historians, the maniacal quality of King Edward's vengeance has always seemed most startling in his treatment of the women prisoners. But one must remember the unique status enjoyed by women in Celtic societies, as priestesses, prophetesses, receptacles, and conduits for royal bloodlines. In Edward's mind, the women of Bruce's entourage must have seemed akin less to Norman chatelaines than to the witches in Macbeth. His army shattered, Bruce himself was forced to flee, seeking refuge first in the mountains of Perthshire, then in Argyll. From Argyll, he escaped to Kintyre, and thence by sea to the island of Rathlin off the coast of Ulster. Here he is known to have passed part of the winter in 1306 and 7, but his other movements and activities before February 1307 are uncertain. It is reasonable to suppose, however, that he spent at least some of his time in Ulster proper, capitalizing on the old Ulster-Carrick alliance and mustering Irish support. Certainly, such support was forthcoming, for when he reappeared, he was accompanied by a number of Irish nobles and their followers. Bruce returned to Carrick in February 1307 with a sizable force and resumed operations against the English. Contrary to the prophecies, Edward's death in July did not interrupt hostilities for very long. For the next 7 years, precisely the period during which the Templars were being harried on the continent and in England, the war in Scotland was to continue, with only sporadic pauses. At a meeting of the St. Andrew's Parliament in 1309, Bruce was officially designated King of the Scots. From this point on, he was effectively sovereign of all Scotland and recognized as such, by his own people, by other heads of state, by everyone save the Pope, who had excommunicated him, and the new King of England, Edward II. The latter was as determined as his father had been to bring the Scots to heel and annex their kingdom to his own domains. In the winter of 1310-1311, Edward launched a fresh offensive. From his experience at Methvane, Bruce had learned not to confront his adversary in a set-piece pitched battle. He was invariably outnumbered. In particular, he lacked knights, the heavily armed and armored mounted soldiery, who, with a mass charge at the critical moment, could bludgeon their way through the most tenacious opposition. In consequence, he resorted to hit-and-run raids, conducted by men in light armor, riding light but fast and maneuverable horses. In fact, to the kind of tactics employed by the Saracens in the Holy Land, he also relied extensively on skilled archers. At the same time, the Scots were beginning to display such much stiffer resistance, much more rigorous discipline, and much more sophisticated martial expertise. By January 1310, moreover, they were receiving considerable shipments of weapons, equipment, and material. Thank you. From Ireland. So extensive had this traffic become that Edward was provoked into issuing an irate proclamation. The king commands the chancellor and treasurer of Ireland to proclaim in all towns, ports, prohibiting under the highest penalties all the exportation of provisions, horses, armor, and other supplies to the insurgent Scots, which he hears is carried by the merchants in Ireland. That was the proclamation. And yet, as perplexed historians have justifiably pointed out, Ireland was no more capable of large-scale military industry than Scotland. Whatever weapons and armor there were in Ireland could only have got there from the continent. It is possible, of course, that the improved competence of the Scottish army was a natural consequence of prolonged conflict, with men becoming progressively more seasoned and experienced. But it is also possible that contingents of the Scottish forces were already being trained and drilled by refugee Templars, who were, after all, the most disciplined and professional soldiery in Europe at the time, and who could have brought with them from the Holy Land the kind of Saracen tactics that Bruce had now adopted. As for arms from the continent finding their way to Ireland and thence to Scotland, it is hard to imagine a more likely conduit for such traffic than the Temple, whose installations in Ireland, when raided by royal authorities, proved, as we shall see, to be virtually denuded of weaponry. Bannockburn and the Templars. Okay. The Battle of Bannock... The Battle of Bannockburn, which was finally to decide the issue of Scottish independence, resulted not from any skillful strategic maneuvers, but from an almost quaint medieval point of honor. Toward the end of 1313, a small English garrison found itself besieged by Bruce's brother Edward at Stirling Castle, the gateway to the Highlands and Argyll. The siege dragged on, unwilling to waste his resources on its indefinite prolongation. Edward Bruce accepted the terms proposed by the defenders. If by midsummer of the following year no English army had appeared within 3 miles of the castle, the garrison would surrender. It was the kind of challenge that King Edward of England could not honorably decline, and Robert Bruce was thus committed by his brother to precisely the kind of set-piece battle he had shunned since Methven in 1306. The English monarch's ostensible objective was to relieve Stirling. The sheer size of his army, however, indicates that his real objectives were considerably more ambitious: to annihilate the Scots, defeat Bruce once and for all, and impose a military occupation on Scotland. Contemporary chronicles speak of the English army as numbering 100,000 men. This is obviously an exaggeration of the kind typical during the Middle Ages. Nevertheless, the muster rolls of the time show that Edward called up 21,640 foot soldiers. Not all of these, of course, would actually have arrived in Scotland after the inevitable attrition resulting from desertion and disease. But those that did would have been complemented by some 3,000 mounted knights, each of whom brought his own trained entourage. Modern historians concur that the English forces must have numbered at least 20,000. Such a figure would have given them a numerical superiority of 3-1, a ratio echoed in the chronicles of the time. The Scots are believed to have numbered between 7 and 10,000. With perhaps 500 mounted nobles or knights, far less heavily armed and armored than their English equivalents. There is still dispute over the precise site of the Battle of Bannockburn, but it is known to be some 2.5 miles from Stirling Castle. The main engagement occurred on 24 June 1314. The date is interesting, for 24 June is St. John's Day, a day of particular significance for the Templars. The precise details of what happened at Bannockburn are vague. No eyewitness account has survived, and such second- and third-hand testimony as exists is distorted and confused. It is generally accepted that skirmishes occurred the day before. It is generally accepted that Bruce, in a classic single combat, killed the English knight Henry de Bohun. Most historians concur that the Scottish army was made up almost entirely of foot soldiers armed with pikes, spears, and axes. They also concur that only mounted men in the Scottish ranks carried swords, and that Bruce had few such men, certainly not enough in numbers, in weight of equipment, and horses to match the English knights. And yet, paradoxically, the 14th century chronicler John Barber states of Bruce that, quote, from the lowlands he could boast of armored men, a full great host, end quote. From such information of the battle as survives, there does indeed seem at one point to have been a charge against the English archers by mounted soldiery, who until then had been kept in reserve as part of Bruce's personal division. But what is most striking in the chronicles is the decisive intervention when all the Scottish units were already engaged, and the entire battle hung in the balance, of what the English regarded as a fresh force, which suddenly erupted with banners flying from the Scottish rear. According to some accounts, this fresh contingent consisted of yeomen, youngsters, camp followers, and other non-combatant personnel, whom the English mistook for fighting men. They had supposedly elected a captain from their own ranks, made banners out of sheets, armed themselves with homemade weapons, and as a volunteer column hurled themselves into the fray. It is a stirring romantic story which does much credit to Scottish patriotism, but it does not ring true. If the intervention was indeed so spontaneous, so improvised, and so unexpected, it would have caught the Scots as much by surprise as it did the English. That no confusion spread through the Scottish ranks suggests the intervention was anticipated. Nor is it easy to imagine the heavily armored English knights, even if they did improbably mistake a horde of peasants and camp followers for professional soldiery, fleeing before an attack launched on foot. All the evidence suggests that the decisive intervention came from some reserve of mounted men. Who might these unknown horsemen have been? The sudden advent of a fresh force, whatever their identity, after a day of combat which had left both English and Scottish armies exhausted, determined the outcome of the battle. Panic swept the English ranks. King Edward, together with 500 of his knights, abruptly fled the field. Demoralized, the English foot soldiers promptly followed suit, and the withdrawal deteriorated quickly into a full-scale rout. The entire English army abandoning their supplies, their baggage, their money, their gold, and silver plate, their arms, armor, and equipment. But while some chronicles speak of dreadful slaughter, the recorded English losses do not, in fact, appear to have been very great. Only one earl is reported to have been killed, only 38 barons and knights. The English collapse appears to have been caused not by the ferocity of the Scottish assault, which they were managing to withstand, but simply by fear. It is hardly credible that peasants and camp followers could have inspired such fear. On the other hand, it would certainly have been inspired by a contingent of Templars, even a small one. However, whoever the mysterious intruders were, they seem to have been instantly recognizable, which Templars would have been by their beards, their white mantles, and or their black and white banner known as the Beauseant? I'm not sure. If they were indeed recognized as such, and if word of their identity spread through the English ranks, the result would have been panic of precisely the sort that occurred. But why, if the Templars did play so crucial a role at Bannockburn, is there no mention of them in the Chronicles? In fact, there would have been a number of reasons for such reticence. From the English point of view, what had happened was too ignominious to be discussed at all, and English accounts are predictably quiet about the battle. As for the Scots, they were intent on depicting Bannockburn as a triumph of their people, their culture, their nationalism, and this triumph would have been in some measure tarnished by suggestions of outside intervention. Then, too, Bruce had very specific political reasons for concealing the presence of refugee Templars in his domains. Although he was still excommunicated, he was also, by 1314, eager for the church's support and could not risk alienating the papacy further. Still less could he risk prompting the Pope to preach a full-scale crusade against Scotland. Something of this sort had occurred in the Languedoc precisely a century before, and the ensuing depredations, which lasted for some 40 years, were still fresh in people's memories. Moreover, his chief European supporter was Philip IV of France, the very man who had first instigated the persecution of the Templars. After the battle, special recognition was conferred on one in particular of Bruce's vassals, Angus Og MacDonald. There's a quote, "The traditional claim of the MacDonalds to fight on the right wing of the royal army, a place of honor, is said to have been granted by Bruce to Angus Og in recognition of the part played by him and his men in the success of Bannockburn." Of the territory around Kilmartin, Loch Awe and Loch Sween, some was royal domain under the administration of the royal bailiff, Sir Neil Campbell, Bruce's brother-in-law. All the rest belonged to the MacDonalds, any Templar settled in the region would, as a matter of course, have fought under the nominal command of Angus Og. Bannockburn was one of the half dozen or so most decisive battles of the Middle Ages, and the largest probably ever to be fought on British soil. It effectively put an end to England's designs on Scotland, which for the next 289 years was to remain an independent kingdom. When at the beginning of the 17th century the two countries were united under a single monarch, it was not through conquest but inheritance. Bannockburn notwithstanding, however, the remaining 15 years of Bruce's reign were still to be stormy. As he lacked male heirs, there were particular difficulties about whom to designate as his successor. In 1315, some 10 months after Bannockburn, the succession was finally settled upon his brother Edward. A month later, Edward Bruce embarked for Ireland, where at Dundalk, in May of the following year, he was crowned king of that country. He would thus, in accordance with the old Celtic dream, have been in a position to unite Ireland and Scotland. In October 1318, however, he died, and the succession to both thrones again fell vacant. In December, it was agreed that on Bruce's death, the Scottish throne would pass to his grandson, Robert, the son of Marjorie Bruce and Walter the Stuart. On 6 April 1320, the extraordinary document, the so-called Declaration of Arbroath, was issued. It took the form of a letter commissioned and signed by 8 earls and 31 other nobles, including representatives of the Seton, Sinclair, and Graham families. This letter adumbrated the legendary history of the Scots from their alleged origins in Scythia and their conversion there by St. Andrew. It described Robert Bruce as their deliverer and hailed him, with biblical comparisons traditionally dear to the Templars, as a second Maccabeus or Joshua. More important, however, is its proclamation of the independence of Scotland and the remarkably modern sophistication of its definition of the relationship of the king to its people. Another long quote, the whole paragraph here. The divine providence, the right of succession by the laws and customs of the kingdom, and the due and lawful consent and assent of all the people, made him our king and prince, to him we are all obliged and resolved to adhere in all things, both upon account of his right and his own merit, as being the person who hath restored the people's safety in defense of their liberties. But after all, if this prince shall leave these principles he hath so nobly pursued, and consent that we or our kingdom be subjected to the king or people of England, we will immediately endeavor to expel him as our enemy, and as the subverter both of his own and our rights, and we'll make another king who will defend our liberties. That's the end of that. Bruce, in other words, was not king by divine right. He was king only insofar as he discharged the duties incumbent upon his office. In the context of the age, this was an unusually advanced definition of kingship. In 1322, Edward II launched his last, rather half-hearted, expedition against Scotland. It came to nothing, and Bruce retaliated with incursions into Yorkshire. In 1323, the two countries concluded what was supposed to be a 13-year truce, which lasted only for 4. In the meantime, Bruce had become embroiled in a new squabble with the papacy, Then in the throes of its own schism, the so-called Avignon captivity. For some time, Edward of England had longed to rid the Scottish Church of its powerful nationalist bishops. Prelates such as Lamberton of St. Andrews, Wishart of Glasgow, and William Sinclair of Dunkeld, brother of Sir Henry Sinclair of Roslyn, signatory of the Arbroath Declaration. To this end, the English king had badgered successive popes not to consecrate any new native-born bishops into the Scottish Church. In the Avignon-based Pope John the 22nd, he found a sympathetic ear. Bruce, however, aligned himself with his own bishops to defy the pontiff's wishes, and in 1318, he was again excommunicated, along with James Douglas and the Earl of Moray. A year later, the Pope demanded that the bishops of St. Andrews, Dunkeld, Aberdeen, and Moray appear before him to explain themselves. They ignored him, and in June 1320 were also excommunicated. Throughout the course of this row, the Pope had persisted in refusing to recognize Bruce as king, pointedly referring to him only as a ruler of the Kingdom of Scotland. It was not until 1324 that Pope John the 22nd relented, and Bruce was finally acknowledged monarch in the Church's eyes. In 1329, Bruce died, to be succeeded as he had arranged by his grandson Robert II, the first of the Stuart dynasty. Before his death, he had expressed the wish that his heart be removed, placed in a casket, taken to Jerusalem, and buried in the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. In 1330, therefore, Sir James Douglas, Sir William Sinclair, Sir William Keith, and at least two other knights embarked for the Holy Land, Douglas carrying Bruce's heart in a silver casket hung around his neck. Their itinerary took them through Spain, where they made the acquaintance of King Alfonso the 11th of Castile and Leon, and accompanied him on his campaign against the Moors of Granada. On 25 March 1330, at the Battle of Tebas de Ardelay, the Scots, riding in the vanguard, were surrounded. According to the 14th century chronicle, Douglas removed from his neck the casket containing Bruce's heart and hurled it into the attacking host, crying, "Brave heart that ever foremost led, forward as though wast wont, and I shall follow thee, or else shall die." Whether Douglas, in the heat of battle, had either time or inclination to compose his thoughts into verse is, one suspects, questionable. Having hurled Bruce's heart at the foe, however, he and his fellow Scots did proceed to follow it, charging headlong into their adversaries. All of them died, with the exception of Sir William Keith, who had broken his arm prior to the battle and so did not participate in it. He is said to have retrieved the heart from the field, miraculously intact in its casket, and to have brought it back with him to Scotland. It was buried at Melrose Abbey under the east window of the chancel. Early in the 19th century, Bruce's grave at Dunfermline Abbey was opened. According to popular traditions prevalent in the age of Sir Walter Scott, he was found with his leg bones carefully crossed immediately under his skull. In fact, this was not so. There was apparently nothing unusual about the corpse. But the traditions are indicative. It is clear that someone had a vested interest in linking Bruce with the Masonic skull and crossbones. And that, finally, friends, is the end of that chapter. Which leads us to chapter 2, the military monks, the Knights Templar. So, some interesting history. It's kind of interesting to see the
actual history of what was going on compared to what we saw in Braveheart, which is a movie I love. Oh, hey, Super Nambro. Did I listen to Bill Cooper's radio shows several years back? No, I have not. He covered the sort of stuff. Okay, I'll have to look them up. I'm sure they're available somewhere. But, yeah. They took a lot of liberties with that movie, that's for sure. but, yeah, I'm going to... let me write that down, because my memory of names is non-existent. Bill Cooper's, okay. All right, cool. Well, they kind of did. I mean, it did say he was drug. Well, I mean, they didn't have him drugged behind a horse, but they did have him tortured, and it kind of implied that he was castrated. He was in the Navy and allegedly saw a UFO tumble up out of the ocean. Oh. Yeah, yeah, what a way to go, absolutely. What did they say? He was like strangled, castrated, hung, cut down before he died. Then I forget all the stuff they did to him. And it was almost like a list of stuff like they said they did to Rasputin, you know, where he was, you know, shot, stabbed, hung, drowned, and still somehow survived it all. Yeah, what a bunch of stuff to happen to you. And then chopped up and spread across the whole country as a reminder not to rebel against the English king. Yeah. But he was not as prominent a figure in some of the other stuff as the movie made him out to be. So anyway, that's enough of that for now. I'm ready to take a quick break and then play some We Happy Few. So, that'll be that. I just got OMG. No, it's not OMG. What's it called? OBS. OBS set up today, so it's not complete. I've got a little work to do during my break to get it set up to game. And then we'll come back in a few minutes for another stream. So I will see you hopefully in a few minutes. No music on the stream end. Didn't get that set up.